of Wells Fargo stock on the open market. That is by far the largest open market sale of Wells Fargo stock that you made in your 9 years as CEO. So my question is, did you dump $13 million of Wells Fargo stock, which you did through your family trust, right after you found out that your bank had been fraudulently opening hundreds of thousands of scam accounts, ripping off your customers?
Thank you for the question. First of all, the vast majority of our people go to work every day
and try to do the right thing. Excuse me, that was not my question.
But I'll get to
your question. Excuse me. My question was, did you dump the stock after you found out about the fraudulent accounts? Because it seems that the timing is very, very suspicious, and it raises serious questions.
I did not sell shares at the time because anything related to
sales. But your Form 4 says you did sell the shares.
I sold the shares. Today I hold four times as many shares as I'm required. I want to stand with our
stockholders. Did you sell these shares or not?
I sold those shares. And I sold them with proper approvals, with no view about anything that was going on with sales practices or anything else.
Well, it seems very, very suspicious that your largest sale was right after your $1.8 trillion bank was turned into a school for scoundrels. You acknowledge that your bank fired over 5,300 people who got caught willfully defrauding your customers, and a recent lawsuit alleges that you fired even more people because they refused to willfully defraud customers. And then you blame the low-level people, you fire them, you make profits, then you dump the stock. So I just have to say that it seems that when you found out about the fake accounts, instead of helping your customers, you first helped yourself. So moving right along to the next question. Mr. Stumpf, you've said that Wells Fargo is conducting a review of all accounts going back to 2009 in order to identify any scam accounts. But last week in the Senate hearings, you were asked if you would extend the review period to before 2009, and you refused to commit to extending the review period back to even earlier. So if you were presented with hardcore evidence that Wells was engaged in some of these practices, these illegal scams prior to 2009, would you change your mind about extending the review?
Thank you for that question. We have agreed with our regulators to go back to 2011. We voluntarily said last week that we'll go back to 2010 and 2009. I've told our team to leave no stone unturned. And if we find a situation where a customer is harmed that goes back prior to that, we will make it right for that customer.
Thank you, because I have the evidence right here. And I'd like to submit to the record a court case in Montana in which six Wells Fargo employees were fired, among other things, ordering debit cards for customers without their permission, which is clearly illegal. And according to the court documents, these illegal sales go back to 2007.
Without objection.
So now we have evidence of illegal sale practices going back to 2007. Will you agree to extend the review period back to 2007 to cover this evidence that we are submitting today?
Again, Congresswoman, we're going to go back to 2009 if we can find, and we're going to contact every customer.
But this is evidence that it went back to 2007. My question is, and we thank you for going back to 2009. My question is, we have clear evidence that it goes back to 2007. Will you live up to your commitment of helping your customers that were defrauded with clear evidence back to 2007?
We will go back, and if we find any evidence of any customer that was harmed to 2007 through our review through 2009, we will take care of each customer.
The time of the gentlelady has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. McHenry, vice chairman of our committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I have the honor of representing the suburbs of Charlotte, North Carolina. North Carolina had an incredible banking culture over decades. Yet in Charlotte, First Union, homegrown bank, great reputation, went through challenging times in the economic crisis, as you well know. But before that time, they teamed up with a bank based in Winston-Salem, Wachovia. And as you know, in acquiring what was then called Wachovia, which was really First Union and Wachovia, the pitch was that your culture from California was very similar to this North Carolina culture, this banking culture. And as you well know, John Grimes Midland, who was a great chairman of Wachovia, sort of imbued in Wachovia this culture that a banker is a civil servant as well. There's this obligation to society they have and their community. You eulogized him.
Yes.
Paid tribute to that culture.
Yes.
So I want to think about that culture, because what is so sad to me is that pitch of culture doesn't conform with my experience with my constituents in North Carolina. It doesn't conform what I know about First Union, what I know about Wachovia, and this cultural pitch that you had in acquiring them in the financial crisis. I know you have a huge headcount in North Carolina. We're grateful for it. But what's sad to me is the impact of this on them and those employees you have in North Carolina. So I wanted to look at your code of conduct that you tout. So let's look at your code of ethics and business conduct. And you said in your message as CEO, we are all responsible for maintaining the highest possible ethical standards in how we conduct our business and serve our customers. The code of ethics, in fact, says our code applies to all team members, including officers, as well as directors of Wells Fargo and Company and its subsidiaries. It also says we are all accountable for complying with the code, as well as all company policies and applicable laws. And finally, it's critical that all team members have a solid understanding of our company's code of ethics and business conduct, and understanding that noncompliance with the policy may result in disciplinary action up to and including termination of employment. You clearly have failed. You've clearly failed in your own ethical standards internally. You have broken, and your company has broken, long-standing law. You've broken long-standing ethical standards that you have within your company. This has nothing to do with this debate about Dodd-Frank or anything else. You've broken a long-standing law, and you've defrauded your customers. How can you rebuild trust? How can you rebuild trust? And how can you get through this thing? What standards are you holding yourself to that sends the message to the rest of these folks in your organization that look to you for leadership and guidance? What are you doing to restore that?
Yes. Well, thank you, Congressman. The culture of the company is strong, and I know...
It's really hard to say that when you're before Congress for the second time, and behind you was all the settlements you've had for problematic relationships you've had with your customers by taking their money, right? Counter to the law, counter to your ethical standards. So it's great that you say you have a strong culture, but why are we here today? How are you addressing that?
Yeah, we are addressing it. First of all, with respect to culture, you know, we have 268,000 people who have made their life's work and careers out of helping customers. There's people today who are out with young...
That's why I raise this in the way that I do, by severe disappointment. That's all. You broke the law. We make the law in Congress. This is not new stuff that all of a sudden Congress changed some rules and you can't have your employees create fake accounts and take fees from customers unknowingly, unwittingly. There's never in human history when that has been an ethical okay. right? So for you to say the culture is okay, this seems to me that you're just tone deaf to this. The final thing you need to think about, and your board of directors need to think about, is this. The impact you have is not simply on your institution, but the wider conversation on how my consumers can access credit. And the implications on what you've done and your leadership has done has this broader societal impact that is very negative.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentlelady from New York, Ms. Velasquez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Storm, now that you were on the Senate side and you testified, and the senators asked you whether or not the 5,300 Wells Fargo employees that were fired for their misconduct, how many of them were fired because they failed to meet sale quotas. At that time, you say you didn't know. Now that a week has passed and you have had a chance to consult your records and speak to your staff, are you prepared to tell us how many employees were fired for failing to meet their sales goals?
Thank you, Congresswoman. Of the 5,300, which is about 1,000 people per year out of our team, and I don't want to minimize it, it was 1%, because we have about 100,000 people in our branch at any one time. All of those people through our investigation were terminated because of their unethical behaviors. We found them. We decided that we can't have them here. They are not consistent with our culture and our ethics.
Out of that 5,300 employees,
yes,
were there any employee that was fired because they didn't meet their sales quota?
They were, from my understanding...
I'm not talking about the 5,300. Outside of that.
Oh, outside of that, my understanding is that people should not be fired, terminated, for missing sales goals. I'm not saying it didn't happen in
some
cases.
How should I trust that that was the case?
And we're doing a review of whoever might have been terminated for that.
Okay, so my next question is, if your review shows that there were employees that were fired because they didn't meet their sales quota, would you be rehiring those individuals?
Yeah, well, first of all, we don't have sales quotas. We have goals, and there's other goals that our people also have as part of their performance management. We're reviewing that, and we're going to try to make it right for every team member.
Mr. Stumpf, I'm sure you are aware that Wells Fargo is the most active SBA 7A lender in the country.
Correct.
As ranking member of the House Small Business Committee, I am very concerned that the legal practices uncovered by the CFPB on the consumer side may have spread to the small business side. Were your frontline employees under similar pressure to cross-sell products to the bank's SBA 7A clients?
First of all, thank you, Congresswoman. We are the nation's largest small business lender. I'm very proud that we do a lot of work helping men and women across this country start businesses and so forth. That's a very different business, and I don't know of any product sales goals, which again, we've eliminated in our retail bank in that business. It's a very different business.
So the 7A program is just a fraction of your overall small business lending portfolio. Can you provide us today with assurances that these illegal practices did not affect any of your small business clients at Wells Fargo?
Yeah, I don't have that information in front of me. I'm happy to work with my staff or team and get back to your staff and cooperate on that as best I can.
Well, so given the fact that you lack the leadership to give us assurances that this was not the case, I'll be writing to the SBA administrator so that they could review all the 7A portfolio to make sure that we protected small businesses as well as taxpayers. My next question to you is, now that you have decided to end product sales goals and financial rewards, have you considered raising the salaries of your retail banking employees in order to make up for this loss in compensation?
Yes, we are working on a new incentive program. It'll be out by the first of the year, and we want to make sure that our team members are totally aligned with our customers, and we want to make sure that compensation for our team, again, who the vast majority do it right, are not hurt in this process.
I know that you're not aware of, but it's very difficult for any person in this country to live with a $25,000 salary.
Time of the gentlelady has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Garrett, chairman of our Capital Markets Subcommittee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, Mr. Stumpf, let me start by making a few observations, then I'll end with a couple questions. First and foremost, I find it, as we all do, extraordinarily troubling that as I look through the history, the timeline of the scandal, timeline that stretches over years, we see, as we've already been testified to, 5,000 Wells Fargo employees were dismissed for their involvement in opening unauthorized accounts. What's also interesting and troubling is the firings did not happen all at one time. My understanding, as we've heard already today, is that roughly 1,000 employees per year, 11, 12, 13, 14, and 15. It's extraordinary how Wells Fargo managed to not actively and decisively move to stop those activities after the first 100 or 500 or 750 or 1,000 employees were fired is beyond me. The fact that it was allowed to go on and on and on for years is apparently a failure of corporate governments and a failure, quite candidly, of your management to do what is foremost, and that is to protect the customers who have trust in you. What concerns me even more, however, is that it appears that most of the 5,000 employees that were fired were low-level or mid-level employees. I think the chairman just found out the highest level was a branch manager. And it doesn't even include those that resigned due to the culture at Wells Fargo. As I say, meanwhile, no, to best of my knowledge, senior executives have been held accountable in the same manner that the lower-level employees were. And I would not be surprised if a number of those people end up losing their homes or going into massive debt after they were dismissed. No, I'm not defending their actions, just making the point that we have a problem in this country where it would seem, as we've seen previously, that the well-connected on Wall Street, or the well-connected here in Washington, the elite, if you will, in Washington or in Wall Street, seem to play by a different set of rules, while everyone else has to play by another. Yes, I know you just lost, reportedly, I hear, $41 million of your salary, but if I understand that correctly, that's only a quarter of your pay over the last decade or so, and so you will forgive all of us if we don't really feel that sorry. Second point I'd like to make is that under Dodd-Frank, Wells Fargo remains fully eligible for taxpayer bailout going forward under Title II of the law, should you run into trouble going forward. Taxpayers have already spent a lot of money bailing out poorly run Wall Street firms over the last decade. Mr. Stumpf, I hope you're aware that the anger now directed at you by my constituents and others around the country isn't just over the actions of the employees, it's the fact that they seem to be forever on the hook to underwrite whatever kind of risky, or in this case, fraudulent activities Wells or other large banks engage in. Fortunately, earlier this month, I'll just make a side note, we passed out a bill out of this committee, the Choice Act, which will ensure that if Wells Fargo does run into trouble again, it's only its shareholders and its management that would pay the consequences, and the taxpayers will no longer be on the hook. Third and final point I'll make, and I know they are not here, but once again, the financial regulators were completely asleep at the wheel as this massive fraud was occurring. If you look at one of those, the CFPB has one job, CFPB has only one job in our regulatory framework, and they completely blew it. It took a reporter from the LA Times to uncover what was going on at Wells Fargo, and so I hope my friends on the other side of the aisle will keep that in mind as they may pat the CFPB on the back for a job well done. So in the time remaining, Let's get to the securities point questions. The Security Exchange Act require a public company to keep a disclosure in place. That's under SOX, require to the CEO and the CFO to attest to financial statements. You referred to some of that. Are you saying that all those quarterly reports you were filing, that the information you had in 11 and 12 and 13 and 14, none of that information was material?
At the time, through the facts and circumstances, we filed accurate reports, and we did not believe it was material.
And when you got the PricewaterhouseCoopers analysis, when was that, by the way?
That was late in 2015, early 16.
And was that, as soon as you had that, has that been filed as a material statement?
We consider the facts and circumstances, and we believe that not to be material.
It's not material. Why not?
Well, remember, or at least this, the PwC material looked at 93 million accounts that we opened over 4 years. They could not rule out through a large data and analytics about 1.5% of those accounts. That's still a lot because of the size of the organization.
Well, that to me, Mr. Chairman, if that's not material, this occurring over a five-year period of time is a systemic problem in the organization, I don't know what is. I yield back.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from California, Mr. Sherman.
Mr. Chairman, the American people need an assurance that this cross-selling mania that has afflicted Wells Fargo is not to be found at the other behemoth banks. And I would urge you to have hearings where we hear from the CEOs of B of A, Citi, the others. And until then, I hope that you would join with me in a letter of inquiry to ask what new account opening quotas they had for their bank tellers, how many people they fired for not meeting their quotas, or how many people they fired for opening phony accounts. We have Wells Fargo before me, but I don't think, Mr. Stumpf, that you should be alone in this joyous experience. Your colleagues should at least come forward with some assurance. We are now engaged in an important national ritual where the CEO comes before the representatives of the American people to apologize, to take full responsibility, to do so humbly. Mr. Stumpf, welcome to Washington. What plane did you fly in on? What airline?
Virgin American.
And when you came to the Senate?
I think it was United, but okay. It was one of the two.
It shows Wall Street's learned something. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, you've got these forced arbitration clauses in your agreement with your customers. You've said, oh, they can have mediation too. Some of them want their day in court. Are you going to hold them to these forced arbitration clauses and screw them again out of their day in court? Or are you willing to waive those clauses and say, if you are caught up in this, you get your choice whether you have arbitration or not?
Thank you, Mr. Congressman. And I believe in arbitration. I think it's a fair way to resolve.
But your customers may want something else. Are you going to deprive them of that?
No, we're not. We're going to have them. We're going to pay for a mediator, and we.
If they want their day in court, are you going to screw them out of that?
This is not. We're taking this very seriously. I told our.
Will you let them go to court if they want to go to court?
We're going
to. Yes or no?
No, but with an explanation.
No, but okay. Thank you. That's a no. This sham was not an attempt to steal a few million dollars in fees from your customers, although that's important. Because you could say that few million dollars wasn't material. What was material is the price of your stock. You opened 2 million phony accounts and then went and told, and it had to be material because you were bragging about it to the people investing in your stock, that you had higher penetration rates, more accounts per customer, that the number of banking customers that had credit cards had grown from the mid-20% up to 42%. So it had to be material. You were talking about it. The peak firings, according to your own documents, was in 2013. So you knew you had a problem then.
Correct.
Why didn't you tell shareholders our penetration rates are phony, our new accounts are phony accounts, and you and when we tell you we're deepening our relationship with our customers, we're doing so by putting them through the ringer? What internal audit system did you have that assured you that you didn't have a material problem?
Congressman, I have to push back here. This is the behavior of people that we found that we did not want, and the vast majority of everything we do is right by our team members and customers.
You were you were firing, according to your own documents, the highest number of people in 2013, but bragging about your penetration rates, the number of accounts opening in 2014. So you knew it was material to shareholders, and you knew it was a phony number that you'd fired people from for falsifying.
Congressman, may I just have a second? Because we've gone back and looked. The 2 million accounts could not be ruled out. We don't know if those are good accounts or not good accounts, because we've already looked at 20,000 credit
reclaiming
cards.
Reclaiming my time, sir, you fired 5,300 people. You took 5,300 good Americans and turned them into felons. With a system that you created, benefited from, and drove your stock price up by bragging about your levels of new accounts.
Congressman,
we know that
I actually disagree with that.
I'm not surprised. We have institutions that are too big to fail. In 2008, we found that they were too big not to bail. Eric Holder has told us that they are too big to jail, saying that he fears for bringing a criminal indictment. We now learn that they're too big to manage, too big to regulate. It's time to break them up.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Missouri, Mr. Lukemeyer, chairman of our Housing and Insurance Subcommittee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Today we're here to confront, in my judgment, a total travesty in a financial market. The consumers in this case were failed on all accounts. Their financial institution, with whom they trusted their family's finances, failed them. The federal regulators who were charged with overseeing the protection failed them. The federal regulators in charge of Wells Fargo failed to stop the ripping off of consumers, and the consumers lost. And slapping a bank with a fine isn't going to make that go away. Only 5% of that fine is going to go back to the consumers who were harmed. Mr. Stumpf, giving back your bonus isn't going to make that go away. More rules and regulations are going to make this go away. Fact is, regulators sat in that bank for years and did nothing. Meanwhile, thousands of employees were being fired for these bad practices, yet nothing was changed to address the issues. The regulators need to be doing their job as well from day one. Instead, the institution pushed forward with a whatever it takes approach to meet sales targets, and regulators sit idly by, either oblivious or uncaring to these bad practices, even after they reported in the news. And top it off, regulators neglected to fulfill their enforcement obligations after the fact. Instead, they opted for a quick settlement and waive their right to pursue additional action for other violations so they wouldn't be viewed as late to the game. Wall Street needs to be held accountable, but so does Washington. That's what we're here today for. So my question to you, Mr. Stumpf, first is, how many regulators do you have in your bank on a daily basis?
I don't have a precise account.
Just roughly.
I think there's maybe the OCC, our prudential regulator. I'd pick 80, for example.
Okay. CFPB, they have some folks in there pretty regularly as well, do they not?
I don't know the number on that.
Okay. Just kind of curious, you know, this as a former bank regulator as well as a banker, this is a really, really disappointing situation for me.
I couldn't agree more.
From the standpoint that I tell people I'm shocked and dismayed. I'm dismayed that the bank allowed this to happen because you did have a culture in place that allowed this to happen. And I'm shocked that regulators sat on their thumbs this long and did nothing. And while you're being fined, which I think is appropriate, the regulators ought to be fined as well. For them to take the fine and keep it is a travesty. They need to be fined as well and let that money go back to consumers because they were asleep at the switch as well. There's so much blame to go around in this. It's unbelievable. A while ago, you made the comment that that you have a good culture in your institution, that this shouldn't be happening. Well, Mr. Stumpf, your own testimony says that you're firing 1,000 people a year. 1,000 people a year. The only one way that can happen, and that there's a culture there that allows that to happen year after year after year. There's a laissez-faire approach to what you're doing in your bank. Somewhere along the line, somebody's got to call a timeout and say, enough is enough. This can't continue. And yet, Year after year, you're firing people, trying to hope this thing goes away, and the regulators are watching it and still sitting on their thumbs. These actions must have consequences, and for not only you, but they need to have consequences for the regulators as well.
Congressman, thank you for that question, because I want to tell you that we did do things. In 2011, within the business, they moved the compliance or the concern for this issue into a compliance area. By 2012, they were reducing goals and doing more ethics training. By 2013, corporate resources were brought in. And we worked with the OCC in 2014, more reductions in goals. In 2015, and the OCC also was in 2013, we did our study. This does not represent the culture. In fact, we do an outside company.
I respectfully disagree with you, Mr. Stumpf. I've been in business like this all my life. You can't tell me that when you have to fire people year after year after year after year, that there isn't a problem. Yeah, for a year or two, that's one thing. But 4 or 5 years?
Yeah.
And this, your own testimony says this. I have another question. I need to go on. I got to talk. In my examining days, I examined a bank one time and found a teller skimming money out of her cash drawer. Took it to the president, and he said, well, you know, she's a good employee. As long as she keeps it to a minimum, I think we're going to be okay. My jaw hit the floor. This reminds me of that situation. As long as they keep it to a minimum, I think we're going to be okay. My comment back to him at that point was, have you reported this to your blanket bond insurance company that has a dishonesty clause on it? Do you have a blanket bond or do you self-insure?
We have a fidelity bond, and that's why we draw a very bright line. When people do the wrong thing, they cannot be here.
When did you report this action of your employees to your blanket bond company?
You know, I don't. We have a group that does that. Our corporate relations with our legal team, and I can share that. We can have our people get to you, but there's a very bright line.
This is a really, really big question, because if you didn't report that immediately when you found this going on, and you allowed for year after year to have 1,000 people.
We do that.
Your blanket bond company is going to be going bonkers over this. We will have a request for that, and I hope you will answer that.
We'll work with
thank
your
you,
team.
Mr. Chairman.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. Meeks.
I can't believe some of what I'm hearing here. So let me understand. You've been the CEO since 2007. You've been the chair of the board and the CEO since 2010, is that correct?
That is correct, Congressman.
And in the time that you have been that chair, I have a chart here that shows you've been penalized almost systematically every year since you have been in charge. Every year. $1.2 billion in April of 16, $53 million in October of 15, $4 million in June of 15, another $24 million in January of 15, $5 million in September of 14. I mean, and I go on and on, $869 million in September 13, while you were the CEO, right? And you're going to tell me that there's not a culture of something wrong at Wells Fargo? When you are the head, you get credit. You get credit as CEO when you bring in all this money, because that's how you get your bonuses. Is that not correct? You get a bonus from your board because X amount of dollars come in. But yet, are you telling me that you don't have the responsibility of losing your position when you have a culture of being fined and costing the bank year after year, month after month? There's no responsibility. You can just stay to be the chairman and the CEO? Is that what you want us to believe?
Congressman, that is not the case. I serve at the pleasure of the board. I'm willing, I've told
then
you.
Then the whole board needs to go if they're going to allow someone to be in charge when time after time. You just talked about you fired 5,300 employees. When you found out that they were doing something wrong, they were fired.
Correct.
Because they were doing something wrong. Well, something is going wrong at this bank, and you are the head of it. So shouldn't the board then turn from your own admission? If the buck stops with you, as you came out here and said, I apologize, the buck stopped with me, and you have to also admit that criminal activity was going on in your bank, then you should be fired because it stops with you.
Well, again, Congressman, the board has that power. That's their, and my energy right now is to lead this company forward.
Sir,
I also want to remind
you came here and you started out by saying, I apologize, etc. If somebody walked into Wells Fargo tomorrow and robbed your bank or defrauded your bank, and then after they're caught, they'll say, well, I'm sorry. I'm gonna take full responsibility for robbing this bank, and I am sorry that I robbed this bank. So please don't prosecute me because I am sorry now that I robbed this bank. Would you allow the person just to walk out after robbing your bank because he is now sorry that he robbed his bank after he took the money already?
Congressman, I see something very different between being honest and breaking our code of ethics and taking advantage of...
You didn't break code of ethics?
And I...
Did your bank... Do you realize that you have not only given... Would you admit this? That not only do your bank have a black eye, that your bank, Wells Fargo, has given the entire financial service industry a black eye. Your responsibility.
Yeah,
you heard Mr. Sherman now. He wants... And I agree with him. He wants everybody to come in here. Why? There's only one reason why. Your bank, you, CEO, chairman, basically for me, was on top of what basically has been a criminal enterprise. Because when I look at consistency, time after time after time and time again, you have to get fines. Now, it must mean that you're making a lot of money because it's easier to pay the fine because you know that nothing else is going to happen to you. So you pay the fine, you get away, you make a lot of money. Now, I'm upset. I'm from New York. I believe in financial institutions. That's why I'm so mad. I believe that they make our country better until they rip us off. And they ripped us off tremendously, taking advantage of customers and consumers when we had the financial crisis. I've got individuals right now who are on the street, they're not back in their homes. They had these fraudulent mortgages. Nobody has said, I'm sorry that we gave you these fraudulent mortgages. We're gonna put you back in your home and we're gonna make sure that everything is okay. No one has done that for them. You haven't volunteered to do that. Will Wells Fargo put people back in their homes?
Congressman, if I could just respond for a second, please. There's no question we don't do everything right. And we've made mistakes. We're upping our game.
So who should pay for it? If he doesn't do anything right, who's accountable for it?
We're gonna make it right for everyone.
Your
of
VP
customers.
Made a $125 million bonus package. Your institution is making over $22 billion yearly. Who is paying for it? Who's taking responsibility for it? Don't come tell me you're sorry.
We're taking care of every one of our customers who is impacted.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Wisconsin, Mr. Duffy, chairman of the Oversight and Investigation Subcommittee.
Good morning, Mr. Stumpf. I want to tell you, I'm a 20-year customer of Wells Fargo. I actually started at Norwest.
Oh, thank you.
My wife was with Wells Fargo. We got married, and it made it easy to join our accounts. I've had a pretty good experience with your bank. That's why I've been there for 20 years. The people I've dealt with have treated me incredibly well, and that's why I'm there. But what I'm hearing today is incredibly disturbing. And so I just want to make sure you and I are on the same page. How do you classify what Wells Fargo did with this potentially 2 million account holders?
Well, the 2 million account holders were accounts was about, the PwC looked at 93 million accounts. The 2 million are...
I'm sorry.
Was this
fraud? Was this just a HR problem? Was this theft? How do you see this?
Yeah, the 2 million accounts could not be ruled out.
I'm asking about how do you classify when you took $22 to $25 from whatever the number is? Maybe it's 1 million, maybe it's 2 million. How do you classify that?
Well, I think it was dishonest. It broke our code of ethics, and the people who are responsible.
Was it theft?
Pardon me?
Was it theft? Did you steal?
Our people did not do what was right.
That's not my question. Did you steal? I want to know if you and I are on the same page. Did Wells Fargo employees steal from 1 million to 2 million of their customers? Yes or no?
In some cases, they did.
They did?
Yes.
And so, as Wells Fargo, back to 2011, is stealing from their customers, and by the way, banking is based on trust.
Correct.
Right? So I don't care if it's 10% or 1% or 0.5% of the people that you do business with. If you're stealing from them, in 2011, 1,000 people are fired for stealing. And what do? You don't fix the problem. And 1,000 people are fired in 2012, and you don't fix the problem. And in 2013, 1,200 people are fired, and we still have a problem.
and you're stealing from people. Listen, I guarantee you that any bank in my community, if they were stealing from someone at the lower level, fired and fixed the problem on day one.
Well, that's what we're trying to do. In fact,
trying to do, we're 5 years on.
Well, let me just say something about, as we understood this problem, we didn't, when somebody would open an unauthorized account, a savings account or a checking account, it was not until, and when an account gets opened and not funded, it's really important, please, when it gets opened and not funded, it gets auto-closed. We didn't believe, as we looked at that, until sometime in 2015, that there could be the possibility of a zero account that could affect a customer.
You gotta be kidding me.
And you have
got to be kidding me.
No, that is absolutely our analysis.
You told us earlier the board members, you were not saying that you knew, but board members knew in 2011. They were looking at this. And if they're looking at 1,000 people fired, that they don't know why they're being fired, that they don't look in to say, what were these people doing that caused them to be canned? And they look, they just pull the curtain back a little bit and they go, man, whether you want to call it defrauding our customers or stealing from our customers, Wells Fargo has a big problem. So that you tell me that it took 1 year, 2 year, 3 year to 2015, I don't buy it. What I think is Wells Fargo was making a lot of money off what you were doing. I think that you were hoping that you wouldn't get caught. And so it's a risk of doing business. You know what? We're willing to fire a few people so I can come into here and go, weren't we great? We fired a couple of people. We were trying to make it right. But we kept the practice in play because we were making big profits. Did you win the practice? Is this over?
And yet we're stopping all of our sales goals. But let me just get
back to your
question.
How could you stop it now but not in 2011 or 2012 or 2013 or 2014 or 2015?
We should have done more earlier, but it's really important I make this point, please. The $2.6 million of fees that were on accounts, that these 2 million accounts that we could not rule out, it cost us $10 million to open those accounts and close them. Forget even the cost of the team member and the dismissal. This is a loser for us. It only helps when customers use products.
Oh, it's a loser for you. I guarantee you that.
It only helps when customers. I'd rather have a customer have two products to use than four they don't. Here's totally aligned with customers.
The concern that we have, Mr. Stumpf, and I told you, I like Wells Fargo. I've been there 20 years. That you were turning a blind eye to your customers who were being stolen from, people who couldn't afford $22, people who couldn't afford $25, and that you didn't fix that problem in an institution that is based on trust with your customer, that you didn't take this seriously, that you didn't remedy it, that it has taken this long. Shame on Wells Fargo, and I didn't get to my question, but I'd hopefully at one point hear you testify to how many CFPB employees were embedded at Wells Fargo. The watchdog.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Capuano.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Stumpf. I want to thank you particularly for doing something here today that no other person has been able to do in the last 4 years. You have brought true bipartisanship to Congress. We're all together on this. We are not happy. The last few minutes, they've been running a graphic in the back, and my colleague went through some of them. But I think it's important to know what some of the other things you have done, what they were. They weren't just fines. You screwed student loan holders, credit unions, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, mortgage holders, African Americans, Hispanics, healthcare workers, on and on and on. And by the way, I understand this isn't material. Just 5 months ago, you paid $1.2 billion in a fine. This is only 15% of that. Who cares? We'll pretend to be sorry, we'll fire some workers, and we'll get through this. You know where I heard that before? The guys who ran Arthur Anderson thought the same thing. We're not your problem. We can't criminally prosecute you. You can keep, hell, you're your own boss. You are the CEO and the chairman. hold yourself to accountability. Oh, my God, you've been bad. Oh, no, you haven't. That's ridiculous. Your problem is coming. It's not today. You think today's tough? It's coming. When the prosecutors get a hold of you, you're going to have a lot of fun. So I want to thank you for that. I want to ask you, you got the graphic up here. Do you know this guy? See, I'm not a real good researcher. I'm not a prosecutor. This is simple internet research. That's all I'm capable of doing. Google it. Wells Fargo. Boom, whole bunch of stuff shoves up. This is Mr. Robert Holmes, who apparently robbed your bank in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. He did not use a weapon. He got caught. They got all the money back. He's in jail as we speak on a $750,000 bail. You, on the other hand, have run an enterprise that has a culture of corruption. You encourage subordinates to abuse existing customers by opening fake bank accounts. You charge those victims illegal fees, interest, and late charges. And then you sent some of them to collection agencies because they didn't pay them. Then you fired 5,300 workers, as if you care, to cover everybody's tracks. In my opinion, you and your entire leadership team are clearly and unequivocally guilty of at least conspiracy to commit fraud, conspiracy to commit identity theft, clearly racketeering, which is something a lot of my friends know something about, and probably a dozen other crimes. Only simple question. What the heck's the difference between you and Mr. Holmes? Why shouldn't you be in jail? He didn't use a gun. You got the money back. I understand that his arraignment, he said he was sorry. What's the difference? Why shouldn't you be in jail right along with Mr. Holmes?
Congressman, I think that when you do something unethical or dishonest, which I've tried to exercise my duties as leader and our senior leadership team.
You haven't done a real good job. You've had 16 violations in 5 years. That's a good job. This is a minor fine. You've had a lot of, this is only the seventh largest fine you've had. You've had six others that are a lot bigger. That's a good job. I guess I forgot. You're the one judging yourself because you're also the chairman of the board. I actually think I'm the greatest congressman in the history of the world. I should be speaker, president, and maybe emperor of the world. That's my judgment of myself. Sound good to you?
There's no question that we've done things that we need to improve on, and we've paid fines, and we're trying to get better on every one of our businesses.
So if Mr. Holmes pays a little fine, you know, a few bucks based on the amount of money he stole and the victims he had, you think he should be let out and have no criminal record?
Again, being dishonest and breaking the law is something very
different. Oh, so it's not breaking the law, stealing my identity and opening an account that I didn't ask for.
And our culture is about not doing that. We train for that not to happen.
I don't know how much kind of a culture you have. 16 violations, 5,300 employees that you say did it.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from California, Mr. Royce, chairman of the House Foreign Affairs Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Stumpf, the idea of a cross-selling target of at least eight products clearly is part of a long-term practice at Wells Fargo. Going back at least to your predecessor, because in 1998, Fortune magazine quotes, doubling the average product purchase to eight as your predecessor's, quote, current obsession. You know, morphing the goal to a mandate here seems to be a big part of the problem, and I say mandate because if people are fired for not hitting that goal, it's a mandate. And that seems to be at the center of a toxic sales culture that you've overseen. But I'd ask you, was the goal of eight cross-sold products something understood and embraced by management and by your sales force?
It was a rallying cry to help work together. The average consumer household has about 14 financial products.
Okay, I understand, but I'm going to ask you a question. In retrospect, do you think that that target contributed in some way to the negative change in your sales culture?
We never had a target of 8. Again, it was an aspirational. We had team members who would work with customers on need-based selling, and when they did that right, the customer won, and it was good for us.
Did you read the LA Times article when it came out in 2013?
I don't. I'm sure I did. I just don't. I can't recall
it right
now.
Was it something discussed at the board level?
We did discuss the LA article.
Well, here's my question. Did the information in that article give you pause about reporting cross-selling metrics or ratios in your annual reports, in your quarterly reports, in the analyst conference calls that were clearly inflated here by fake accounts generated by your sales force?
We love cross-sell because it helps define.
I understand your argument about that. Here's the question. If you know fake accounts are going into that ratio, why would you keep reporting that ratio? Because I've got a copy here of your investor day. I've got a copy of what is in your quarterlies. And, you know, you turned to Mr. Duffy here when he was asking the question, and you were saying, well, it isn't that material in terms of our bottom line, in terms of the fee income from these fake accounts. But what you're reporting on your products per household is a constant upswing quarter by quarter by quarter. It certainly is material in terms of the stock price. What you were doing in constantly reporting these ever-increasing numbers was driving your stock price up. And the point I'm making is you have this story in 2013 that shows how much of that was based upon fraudulent behavior. That becomes material, right?
Well, let me just talk about that specifically. The cross-sell ratio, even if you include all 2 million accounts in that, and we know we can't because we're already finding out in credit card that 75% or less than 25% either did not order it or do not remember. We've looked back for all the quarters going back to, I can't remember, it's 2010 or 11, and it has a, I think, 1/200 of one product impact. It's absolutely immaterial.
Look, Mr. Stumpf, this is a California company. You've got a lot of California customers. You've got people all over the world dependent upon this company. You've got your employees, and from what I understand, 1,000 of them being fired a year connected to this. I believe rebuilding the trust and righting the wrongs are going to take a course of action here that I've yet to see you set. And through opening unauthorized accounts or playing the shell game with a person's money, your employees and your company negatively impacted the credit of many people in this country. And I just want you to think for a minute about what that meant in terms of their ability maybe to qualify to get that home, or maybe to qualify to get that car, or maybe in terms of the student loan to send that son or daughter to university. Not to mention, again, working Americans wrongfully terminated by your company for what? Refusing to break financial laws, refusing to break ethical laws. That's what we have to come to grips with here. And this is, at the very least, the result of actions over the last 5 years. That didn't happen by accident.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Lynch.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a unanimous consent request to enter to the record a letter sent by Ranking Member Cummings, gentleman from Maryland of the Oversight Committee, to Mr. Stumpf requesting related documents by October 13th.
Without objection.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would also like to ask the chairman to consider doing a hearing at a later time with a number of the employees, both whistleblowers who were fired and others who were fired for retaliatory attempts to provide information on the fraudulent conduct being conducted at Wells Fargo. I'm aware of at least three U.S. attorneys that have also issued subpoenas in this case, so I'm hopeful that we may eventually get to the bottom of this. And while the city of L.A., the city attorney there, and the CFPB and the OCC have done good work in this case, the fines thus far are pathetic, really, totally inadequate to try to bring Wells Fargo into compliance with the law. And that is certainly reinforced by the way, Mr. Stumpf, you have diminished the offenses that have gone on at your bank. It is really, you know, proof positive that whatever the OCPF the OCC has done is not adequate to make you realize the level of your offenses here. Again, the 5,300 employees were fired, up to 2 million fraudulent accounts, and this has gone on for at least 5 years. And I want to point out here, and Mr. Duffy has hit on this, this is the banking industry. It exists based on trust. And what your employees did, at least, well, as many as 565,000 fraudulent credit cards were secretly opened by your employees using the Social Security numbers of your customers. So they opened fake credit cards so they could charge them for that. They assigned fictitious PIN numbers when the customer didn't even know that was going on. They put PIN numbers, and then they assigned email addresses so they could comply with it and get the bonus so that the account was open. And these are your customers. Now, we've had credit card companies up here who have sent credit cards to non-creditworthy borrowers and seniors who didn't understand they were getting. But in this case, these are your customers. These are the people that they became victims because they did business with your bank. That is unbelievable. And, you know, I know that Mr. Meeks and Mr. Capuano before me have made comparisons to criminal activity, but I do want to note that under the Racketeer Influence and Corruption Act, you've satisfied that. You've satisfied all the elements of that. Two of the predicate events, offenses in under RICO. Number one is fraud, and there's no question about that. Mail fraud, securities fraud. You've done it all. You've covered basically every aspect of fraud in your bank over the last 5 years. And secondly, in many cases, these employees, these whistleblowers, were intimidated or fired in some cases. You got an HR employee here who says you had a system to retaliate in your bank against whistleblowers. And that's another predicate offense under RICO. So let me ask you, as the CEO and chairman of the board, you had a responsibility to file SARs, suspicious activity reports.
Correct.
Right. You have up to 2 million separate accounts being opened, up to 565,000 bogus credit cards being opened by your employees in secret against your customers. And yet, when we asked FinCEN, we asked the Treasury Department for the suspicious activity reports that you filed, they don't match up. You're not in compliance.
Well, let me just say a couple of things. We filed and we did everything that was necessary to abide by every regulator and regulation issue.
Are you saying you filed suspicious activity reports on?
I can't say on that because that's...
Well, it's your responsibility. Let me read you the law.
I know.
I'll close with this.
It's a responsibility, but there's actually a prohibition. I mean, I have to do what's right.
All right.
According to the law.
All right. Let me just explain. All right. This is my time. I'm claiming it back. The board of directors, this is under the Bank Secrecy Act and Anti-Money Laundering Statute. The Board of Directors acting through senior management is ultimately responsible for ensuring that the bank maintains an effective Bank Secrecy Act, AML, internal control structure, including suspicious activity reporting and monitoring.
And we
it's
do
your
that.
Your responsibility.
And we do that.
The time of the gentleman, has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Oklahoma, Mr. Lucas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Stumpf, while my day job is that of a congressman, I am a farmer by trade, and my university degree is in agricultural economics. And looking at your resume, about the time you were entering into the banking industry 30-some years ago, I can remember taking a class on money and banking at Oklahoma State. And we had a professor who was very enthusiastic about the market economy, and we discussed how the banking model we use now went back essentially 500 years to Italy, and the concept that under a market economy, bankers were the individuals who determined what savings were worth and pooled those, mm-hmm. and by the same token, made risk determinations, figured out what the cost of money should be, and allocated that out through loans. A glowing example. And he would compare Western Europe at the time, North America, much of the rest of the world, how effective that was compared to the demand economy model of the old communist countries at the time, China, Russia, all of those sort of places. A very glowing discussion. I don't know that I have a particular question for you about what's going on. I think between the other committee and my colleagues here, they've done an exceptional job of getting to the facts. And I suspect, as a number of my colleagues have discussed quite straightforwardly, this has legal implications far and beyond the activities of this committee or the other committee and the other body. But I'd say, Mr. Chairman, the most challenging thing you've done is, by the actions of your company, by your management of the company, you've made it really hard for those of us who are defenders of the market economy to continue to maintain the system that has helped drive this successful enterprise called the United States of America and the free market system. That's probably the most tragic thing about this. Now, in those econ classes, you used to lecture us about the concepts of enlightened self-interest. That's the nature of any consumer. That's the nature of any business person. But then there are the responsibilities we used to talk about of good corporate citizenship, about self-restraint, about not pursuing greed. I guess I just simply note to you, sir, whatever ultimately legally comes out of this process, and clearly a number of my colleagues think something will, or whatever your stockholders determine, or your fellow board members, you've just made it really hard for those of us who want to maintain that concept of a market economy, who want to continue to make sure that bankers, not some bureaucrat somewhere, are the arbitragers of capital to effectively make this country move forward. I don't know how you correct this, but I suspect, sir, when you interact with your peers within the industry, you're going to have some challenges for a long time to come, because the brush with which you will be painted will stroke all of them too. And I suspect that's blatantly unfair, and it's unfortunate. But then, you know, I'm just a farmer by trade, multi-generation debtor, working hard to service my debts every year. But you have to think about that. You have to think about that. What this episode has done to your industry and ultimately to me and all of my fellow consumers out there. It's just very unfortunate.
May I make a comment?
Please.
Thank you. And we take this very seriously. And I also come from a farm. I understand what it's like to be on a small farm, or at least ours was small, with a large family. I know right from wrong. I know we have a lot of wrongs to right here. But I also wanted to tell you that Wells Fargo is a great corporate citizen. We employ 268,000 wonderful team members across the country. We have a culture based on ethics and doing what's right. Not everyone does that. We've made mistakes. We're one of the nation's largest taxpayers. We're one of the largest philanthropic organizations. We're involved in our communities, and we have a lot of work to do. There's no question about that. But I stand with the people who are doing the right thing, who honor our culture and our ethics. They are terrific people, and they're out there with our customers every day. And we have work to do. I understand that.
A disservice has been done to them. With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Scott.
Yeah, Mr. Stumpf, this is one of the most outrageous acts that any banking executive has done in my lifetime that I know of. How in the world could you, in good conscience, set up these fraudulent accounts? What was going through your mind when you were doing this?
Congressman, I didn't set up any of these accounts. Our team worked together at the business level, then at the corporate level, to find these accounts, and we found these people, and we said that behavior is not possible.
Mr. Zanoff, you took advantage of unsuspecting, loyal customers. People in almost every single district that's represented on this Financial Services Committee. You did that. And you are the chief executive officer. You set the tone. And you should be downright ashamed of yourself. And you should apologize right now. If you have any strain of respect for the people of the United States, for the customers that you have defrauded with this, for the rancid example that you're setting, and not only that, for the damage that you yourself with your action is being done to the entire banking industry. Because you know what? All this cross-selling, now you have caused an extraordinary spotlight to be focused on every bank in this country. You have done that.
Congressman.
And you should apologize.
Congress, I have said in my opening testimony, I am sorry. I am accountable for this. I'm very sorry that we broke trust with our customers, our communities, the American people. I am deeply sorry for that. I'm doing everything I can to repair that.
And you know what hurts me so much? I'm one of your customers. I have an account in Wells Fargo, in the bank, in Atlanta, Georgia. I was on the phone with my district director about this, and she has told me that our constituent services, when it comes to the mortgage assistance, particularly with the bill that we passed here, the hardest hit bill, mm-hmm. in which we're offering and helping those people with mortgages to be able to pay up to 24 months of free mortgages. Mm-hmm. And she says, we have no better cooperation from the staff of banks than we have from Wells Fargo.
Thank you.
I'm your customer, and what's doing?
Thank
you. But the example that you set is just absolutely terrible. Now, what I want to ask you is, because my number one concern is my constituents in Georgia. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you, could you tell us exactly how many customers of yours in my home state of Georgia had fraudulent accounts set up in their name without their consent? How many in Georgia?
I can get that for you if I have the right. Sorry, I know I'm using up your time here.
Well, maybe the chairman will give me a little extra here, but it's important for us to know. How many
in Georgia?
Yes, sir.
We had 55,579 accounts that we could not rule out as possible. Again, now I just
55,000.
If you may let me. We're finding out that on the credit card side, less than 25% did not want those. But here's my commitment to you, Congressman. We're going to work with every one of these accounts and make it right for every customer. That is our commitment. I'm interested in results, not in process here. Each account, we're going to take care of it. And I don't care whether there was, and the biggest thing here is secondary harm. I want to make sure that I think it was asked by another congressman or woman about that issue. We take this very seriously.
My time is scratching down. Here's the fundamental question I want to ask you. Do you think what you did was criminal?
I'm not a criminal
attorney. No, but do you think Do you think that?
I led the company with courage and with the
If another bank president had done this, or chief executive officer, would not you say it's criminal?
I didn't break our code of ethics, and I didn't do anything
dishonest. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from New Mexico, Mr. Pierce.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, sir. Appreciate you being here. I suspect it's not all fun. So you talked about the 5,300 that were terminated. Is how big a percent of the people in the company that were terminated? Surely out of 268,000 people, you'd get more than 5,300 terminated. So what percent of the terminations did that actually represent?
You know, I don't have that. I can work with our team and see what
I mean,
that's
okay.
I don't have that.
So just looking at this from the 30,000 foot viewpoint, and keep in mind I'm like Mr. Lucas, grew up on a small 5-acre farm. Dad was a sharecropper before he went to work as a roustabout. We had a blue-collar company just working there in oil fields of southeast New Mexico, so all the numbers that get thrown around here are a little bit big, but I can't fathom somewhere in the process that you got 5,300 people terminated and that doesn't come to your attention as a CEO. You get calls on the ethics line saying, hey, we're doing unethical stuff, 2008, according to one of the other people. According to your comments, people inside your company are breaking the law. They're creating criminal acts, and that doesn't come to your attention. You get $10.8 billion in settlements, and that doesn't come to your attention. So what, if I'm sitting here thinking about this stuff just coming in a clear, just quiet room, bored, seeing these things, at some point somebody's going to say, Houston, we got a problem. But it doesn't appear that anybody ever said, Houston, we got a problem. The L.A. city attorney brings charges, and nobody on the board says, Houston, we got a problem. What, in your assessment, looking back, what was it that would cause all those things to go under the radar and not be recognized, not be seen?
Thank you for that question. As we learned more about this issue, we made investments. We made investments in training. We reduced sales goals. We brought in a regulator.
You've been through that.
Okay.
What kept you from seeing? What kept this from rising to the... I'm sure that today that you probably consider the problem somewhat different than you did in 2011, 12, 13, 14, 15. Why did not you see the importance that you would attribute to it today at any stage of the process?
Congressman, it's a good question. I've said in my testimony,
I did not see the answer. Well, what? Since you appear not to want to see it, I'm sitting here, and a balanced scale as a business manager is always there. Do we want to take that job cleaning out that well, and we can't clean it out, and we get a bad reputation? That's worth a lot. Maybe we will, or maybe we won't. Are we going to overlook the numbers of terminations? We're getting the calls. Don't we really want to investigate? The stock price is doing okay. Well, my compensation is okay. You get the balances there. Your compensation in that period of time is approximately $200 million. That would cause one to say, I think things are running okay. Yeah, maybe we got that little problem over there. But another thing on the side of the scale that says, I don't want to look at this, or I can't see $10 billion in settlements, that it just doesn't come to my attention. 5,300 terminations doesn't come to my attention because we got 260,000 employees. Obviously, we're doing things 99% right. Forget the 2 million people that we defrauded. Mostly, we're doing okay. And so I see size and complexity being a great problem. When you can't see 5,300 people being terminated, when you can't see $10.8 billion in settlements, then you've got a problem in size and complexity. And I would say that there is no community banker in this country that would not have seen people doing illegal acts. And so maybe it was your stock compensation. Maybe it was the size and complexity. But, sir, I think today, listening to things that everyone has said, you have proved that you did not offer leadership in this. You have kind of shirked around and said the board can do anything it wants at any time. I, sir, think you ought to submit a resignation, and your board cannot hold off action on that. Thank you. Yield back.
Mr. Chairman, may I just make a comment about that?
Witness may comment.
We did take accountability. We did invest in things to help reduce this, and we saw the numbers coming down.
The problems continued right on through your actions. 2011, you did this. 2013, you did that, and the problems continued.
The time of the gentleman has expired. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Green, ranking member of the Oversight and Investigation Subcommittee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the ranking member as well. I'm grateful that you have given us a very positive response and we are holding this hearing. Mr. Chairman, with $5.6 billion in earnings in the second quarter, Wells Fargo is not in this because of need. This is about greed. It's about the same kind of greed that created credit default swaps, that created negative amortization, that created no-doc loans, that created prepayment penalties that coincided with teaser rates. The same kind of greed called exotic products that created the housing bubble. This greed has caused this cross-selling to become the equivalent of an exotic product, a product that has now created a cross-selling bubble for Wells Fargo. The cross-selling bubble exists because you were marketing yourself as a company in a growth mode by virtue of the new products you were having with your customers. You had customers that were coming in and you were growing. This enticed investors, it enticed consumers to buy your stocks. When your stocks were bought, it benefited you and top-level executives to the detriment of lower-level entry employees. They get fired, top-level executives get golden parachutes, and it's business as usual. Well, Mr. Chairman, this will not end by simply having some lower-level employees go to jail. If top-level executives go free, and lower-level employees go to jail, it doesn't end it, because there is no reason for this to cease and for top-level employees to be more mindful of what's going on. So we've reached a point now where the public expects to see more than lower-level people punished. 5,300 working people who, by what I seem to read, were encouraged to the point of having themselves coerced to engage in this activity. These were people who were trying to make a living, not trying to make a big bonus and a big payday. These people deserve a fair day, not just an exit from your company. And what do I mean by a fair day? I think they deserve an opportunity to be heard in terms of what happened at Wells Fargo to cause them to do what they've done. I think that they ought to be given an opportunity to come before Congress. They ought to be able to explain. And I would also add this. We have to find out how pervasive this bubble is. We have to. We do have to bring before the Investigations Committee, Oversight Investigations, other CEOs, top-level executives, and let them tell us. And I think that we have to start with you. So tell me, please, sir, how commonplace is this cross-selling in the banking industry?
Thank you, Congressman. For our company, cross-sell is a good thing because it represents the depth of
ratio. If you would, I'm going to have to intercede. I have to intercede because I'm asking you about the industry now.
I have no idea what
you have no idea as to how pervasive the product is?
I don't know what other companies use.
Well, are they using cross-sell? Are you saying you have no belief or no idea that other companies are cross-selling?
I do not have that.
I must tell you, I cannot believe your answer. You're telling me that you have no idea that as to whether or not they even engage in cross-selling?
I don't know their performance management.
But do you know that they engage in it?
Every bank, every retailer out there has some motivation, some way to make sure they recognize their people.
Do they engage in cross-selling?
Well, I don't know their situations. I'm honest
you,
with
you. You don't talk to your colleagues. You don't talk to other bankers. You have no idea as to whether they engage in cross-selling?
I don't know what they use.
Well, listen, I thank you for your answer. Let me finish. Because, Mr. Chairman, this is the evidence that we need to bring the others in. We have to ask them what they're doing, given that this gentleman refuses to give us what I believe to be a correct answer.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Posey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Stumpf, members of this committee have already expressed outrage that we all feel. That this atrocity was able to happen. It's absolutely deplorable that your customers were subject to this practice. And I'm sure the fine that Wells Fargo will pay will be insufficient to comfort the customers or adequately compensate them. At best, at the very best, you and our federal regulators were asleep at the switch. You know, at worst, it's almost, if not, a criminal enterprise. My biggest concern, and I think it's the biggest concern of every member on both sides of the aisle here, is that we need to ensure that it doesn't ever happen again. That means we have a shared interest in understanding what caused and what perpetrated the unprecedented level of fraud, and I have just a couple of questions that I think will help drive us in that direction to understand it. First, Mr. Stumpf, I understand that Wells Fargo sets goals for new banking products. Each employee was expected to sell daily. Is that correct?
I don't believe that's the case. I know as part of our reward system and our performance management that products was part of performance management along with customer service, customer loyalty, doing things right. But again, as of this Friday, we're getting rid of those goals.
Okay. I've read a range of reports that puts these sales goals somewhere between 8 to 5 new sales each day compared to the reported industry standard of 3 to 5 per day. Briefly, I was going to ask you if you could give us an idea of how the goals were determined.
It determined within our business. I wasn't part of that process, and I don't know if that's you made reference to an industry standard and what ours is. Okay. I wouldn't have specific. Okay. I can try to get back to you.
Are you aware if the expected targets vary between bank branches of different size, location, or constituencies?
I believe that is the case, yes.
You think they did?
I believe that that was, I don't know when that was introduced, but I believe in the past, you know, locations that would have more activity, we'd either have more bankers or more goals.
Thank you for the straight answer.
Okay.
As a follow-up, did the bonuses associated with those goals vary between those branches, or did Wells Fargo use a single uniform system?
Again, that's a level of detail I don't know. I can try to get back to you on that.
So far in the investigation of bad actors, have you found any correlation between the likelihood of employees committing fraud and the demographic or socioeconomic characteristics of the people being served?
Yeah. First of all, I'm not trying to be careful on words here. I don't know what fraud exactly. I mean, I know what's right and I know what's wrong, and I don't know what the intent of all these people were. But to answer your question specifically, there was no that I understand racial or ethnicity difference other than what the communities are, because we try to have people in our banks that represent the communities.
All right. So we'll take racial and ethnicity off the table here. As someone who also represents a district heavily populated by seniors, I'm worried that Wells Fargo
may have intentionally preyed upon those they saw as vulnerable. Do you believe seniors were purposely targeted as a result of employees stretching to meet their sales goals?
Yeah, in fact, we've looked at, because we actually capture date of birth so we could tell that, and no, there was no disproportionate, it did not, in fact, it was younger people, not seniors, okay. If there was any emphasis at all or any...
Okay. To be clear, I don't think sales goals are inherently evil. Anyone who's owned a business understands the need to incentivize employees to succeed and reward their successes. Unfortunately, your company forgot the most important part of any business, more important than sky-high stock prices, year-end bonuses, or fat retirements. It's the people that you serve. I'm increasingly concerned that this misguided idea of success that puts actual customers in a category of least concern is perpetrated more than just Wells Fargo, by the way. To the best of your knowledge, was this practice of creating fake accounts exclusive to Wells Fargo?
You know, I don't know, and I only know that what I know about our company, but I'd also like to make, if I could just, in your few seconds left, the investment reason people buy Wells Fargo invest in us is a whole lot more. It's about our broad product model. It's about our distribution in the United States. It's about our loans and deposit growth.
Can you tell me any action the CFPB has taken that would stop something like this from happening again?
Brief answer from the witness.
We've worked with the CFPB. We made an agreement with them, and we're going to continue to work with them on this issue.
But any action that they've taken that would stop it from happening again? Time of the gentleman has expired. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from Missouri, Mr. Cleaver, ranking member of our Housing and Insurance Subcommittee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Stumpf, thank you for being here. I know you're not, this is not one of your better days, but you know, hopefully you understand. I have a plane to catch. I may not finish my time. And I dare not get on a plane and go back to Kansas City and conduct myself in a way that everything is fine and we'll all join hands and sing Kumbaya and fix the problem. One of the reasons that everybody in this place is upset, we each of us represent about 840,000 people. And probably every one of them is angry, especially those who had problems, you know, getting loans and people who were ripped off during the crisis from 2008 and 9. And so I think many of them, you know, think that they had a preview of this garden gecko. Greed is good. Greed is right. Greed works, and from the movie Wall Street. And I think that's one of the problems we have here. Now, you've already been warned before I had my opportunity, so I'm not going to warn you. But I do need to ask you a couple of questions, maybe just one. You know, there were 2.6 million in overdraft charges that incurred on linked accounts and late fees. There were thousands of consumers on fire, figuratively, and your bank had tubs of water, but the people there decided to drink it and let the people burn. Including the people who gotten fired, my question is, how far up the chain have you been able to determine that this scheme, this fraud occurred?
We know that 5,300 people broke our trust, were not honest, and we know that we are going to do a complete review of anybody who would have been part of this. And if they were dishonest and broke our code of ethics and took advantage of our customers, they will be held accountable. And we've returned that money with interest with an apology.
Yes, I know, but I'm trying to find out how far up the chain have you determined thus far that this scheme went.
Yeah. Well, first of all, it was most of our people do it right, and this was just the opposite of what we trained for, just the opposite of what we talked about. So when I say it's a scheme, I mean it's again 1% of our people. And I know that's a lot of people given our size of our company, but we'll do a full review, and we're going to do a review of that.
God bless you. But what I'm trying to find out is how far up the chain.
We're not going to let the chain impede.
Sir?
We're not going to let the chain impede. The board's going to do a review and a company to make sure everybody's held accountable.
Okay. So okay. Thank you. I appreciate that. Now,
thank
how
you.
Far up the chain?
So far, of the people that we have found, it is branch managers, their manager in some cases, and a manager of a manager. So that's the work we've done so far.
So the manager of manager would be a vice president?
Yeah, I don't know exactly the title, but I think it's called an area president.
Area?
Yeah, I think it was an area president.
Okay. So have any of those folk been fired?
Pardon me?
Have any of them been fired?
Yes.
All the vice presidents?
Well, I don't know. Again, I don't know if this person was a vice president. I don't know what the title was, but I know it was a banker, then branch manager, manager of the branch managers, I think uh-huh. They're called district, and then an area manager.
So no matter how high it goes, they're going to be fired?
They're going to be held accountable. I can't say I don't want to prejudge that.
No, I understand. I understand. So no matter how far it goes up, they're going to be fired.
As far as you go up, they'll be held accountable, whatever that means. Thank you.
Time of the gentleman has expired.
That's now, everybody's beating you up.
Pardon me?
Chair now recognizes the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Fitzpatrick.
Thank the chairman. Mr. Stumpf, I want to follow up on Mr. Cleaver's questions. First of all, I represent a district outside of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. And I, like probably most of my colleagues here, have received letters from your customers, from our constituents, from former employees of the bank. And they have a lot of questions mm-hmm. of their own, which we have to help them try to answer. First, I want to ask sort of a foundational question. This is a question that you've been asked many times already today, last week in the Senate, about when you first heard of this situation, the so-called situation with your customer accounts. And you've given us approximate dates, which we appreciate. But first and foundationally, if you could tell the committee, tell the American people, when you first heard about the problem, where were you? Who told you? What did they say to you? What did you do about it?
Yeah. Okay.
At the first moment.
So I'll answer your question, and thank you for that. I've always known, as I think most Americans know, that not every bill deals with everything right every day, and we have, 100,000 different people in this business. So we knew, and I knew, that this had to be managed, and it was being managed in the business. Sometime later in 2013, before the LA story came out, because that did not surprise me, because I had heard that we are seeing an acceleration of this activity in a certain marketplace. And I can't recall if Chief Legal Counsel told me, I can't remember if it was in a meeting with the business leader at the time or compliance, and that's when I first knew that this was becoming a bigger issue. So resources were brought in to bring corporate resources in to assist the business line, and then the business and the corporate group called CORE spent time working on that issue, and we saw the issue come down. It was not until 2015, and we should have learned earlier,
Mr. Stone, you're not asking the question. When you first heard, where were you, who told you, and what did you do about it when you first heard?
Again, I don't remember where I was sitting, what I was doing, where I but I recall hearing at some time in the summer fall time frame of 2013. I don't remember the exact minute or the person.
Mr. Stumpf, there have been so many people who've been hurt by what we know right now. Not just your customers, you're going to lose
Correct.
Many customers, mm-hmm. never get them back. There have been lower level and mid-level employees who've been injured. You mentioned earlier in your testimony, 268,000 people went to work today
Correct.
At Wells Fargo to do the right thing. And for the most part, we all believe that. You also mentioned there were some 5,000 employees who lost their positions. As employers, we're responsible when you bring somebody young into an organization, somebody perhaps right out of high school or right out of college, you have
Correct.
A special responsibility to that employee, to train them, to make sure that they're being trained in the ways of ethics in banking. How many of those lower-level employees were part of the 5,500 who lost their jobs?
Yeah, the vast majority, and I don't have exact numbers, but I believe about 7% or so would have been at the teller population, and the remainder, the other 93%, were someplace, and that's my understanding, were banker, senior banker, branch manager, and so forth. And incidentally, we do give 2 weeks of training for all of our team members before they go out into the, because you're right, we have a special responsibility to help them understand our culture. They sign a code of ethics and we...
They're being told in those employee trainings about the so-called goals, quotas?
They're told about all the responsibility of their job, including I've done town halls, which I do every quarter. I did one in Philadelphia just a couple of months ago. And I've been talking in generally in every one of those. Generally, I talk about doing the right thing, putting customers first,
Mr.
ethics.
Stump, there've been reports from multiple whistleblowers from the bank that they provided information up the chain of command and were ignored. As a matter of fact, some of them were fired. Are you familiar with those cases?
I've heard about those. Those are regrettable. We have a non-retaliation policy on whistleblowers.
You know, being fired in the federal government for being a whistleblower is a very serious matter. Hopefully you're taking it as seriously as anybody else would.
We're taking that very seriously. We have a non-retaliation policy.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentlelady from Wisconsin, Ms. Moore, ranking member of our Monetary Policy and Trade Subcommittee.
And thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and want to welcome our witness here today. I've learned so much here, and I know when you go to the Wells Fargo website, there your picture is, John G. Stumpf, the vision and values of Wells Fargo, and it features you. You say that you started with Wells Fargo in 1981?
In 1982.
In 82, okay, my math is not that good. You succeeded Mr. Kovacevich, and they had already started so you were trained and you knew what the culture of this Norwest company, I guess that was a merger of Wells Fargo and Norwest. And so did you receive training, or do you know if the employees were received training on this Going for Great program that we've talked about here today, where, you know, most of your customers only had 5 accounts in your bank, and that there was an effort to get at least 8 sort of accounts for the customers. Was that part of the culture?
Yeah, thank you for the question. As I mentioned before, that was an aspirational goal. Most of our customers have, most households have 14.
All right, okay, so I don't have much time.
Okay.
As your predecessor noted, there is just abundant growth potential in the Wells Fargo customer base, and that one of the sayings around that place was, hey, we inspect what we expect. Mm-hmm. So were there constant monitorings to see if people were meeting these goals? It says that we inspect what we expect. What does that statement mean?
Yeah, that statement means that we expect our people to live according to our vision and our values, our ethics,
right.
and our culture. Well, they don't.
Well, good. I am so happy. I'm going to congratulate you on draining the swamp of these 5,300 low-level employees, and because they almost brought down one of the greatest companies that our country has ever known. I remember Wells Fargo, the old wagon train days. So I'm happy that you got rid of those employees. And I am sorry for your loss of your $41 million, and I'm sorry for the loss of the investors whose stock dropped. But I am wondering what the relief is for one of my constituents, and I have her letter and I want to enter it into the record. She worked at Wells Fargo.
Without objection.
Okay, thank you. And she started making $13 an hour, and she ended making $15 an hour. And she was one of those whistleblowers who complained to the manager. And then they changed her performance numbers and pushed her out. And so she's the person that kind of lost her job and other stuff that happens to you when you make $13 an hour. $15 an hour, I'm sorry. And you're pushed out by people because you don't want to, because you don't fit in with the expectations and the culture. What is the remedy? Is there a fund for these employees, the good ones, not these 5,300, you know, what was it, $12 an hour, $13 an hour employees? What is the remedy for my constituent at Wells Fargo? I know.
We want to know about everyone. And we're going to review their files for anyone who had anything to do. If they were,
she has a case with the Wisconsin Equal Rights Division. How come she couldn't just come to you and tell you?
And we have people that she can talk to.
The people she talked to fired her.
We have corporate resources here. If you could give me that name, Congresswoman, okay. And let our people know.
I want to ask a question. I have 49 seconds. I was very disturbed to hear about you. You said that the numbers were just not large enough to rise to the level of being material for security law purposes. I guess I don't understand that. Would you, as an investor, invest in sort of the Bernie Madoff type enterprises? This seems like it was these huge dividends. Would you make this kind of investment yourself?
This is not any, you know, this is a quality company who made some mistakes, but our investment thesis is all about our capital, our growth.
I got 9 seconds left, and I just want to ask this one question. You have stated previously that you think the Dodd-Frank overregulates. Do you still believe that?
I've never said that.
Oh, really?
I don't recall saying that.
Time of the gentlelady has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Indiana, Mr. Stutzman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Mr. Stumpf. I tell you, I got my first loan from Norwest Bank for a motorcycle when I was 20 years old, and I've been a happy customer of Wells Fargo for over 20 years.
Thank you.
And I have been frustrated with Wells Fargo as of late because of the new website, and I've voiced that. And I think part of this. I think you need to do something about it because the transparency in the website right now, I can't find some of my accounts. And I think that there needs to be, at this point, a time where you can give customers confidence through the website to make sure that every account can be seen. Because I got notices all of a sudden of accounts that I didn't recognize because I didn't see them on a daily basis. I found them after I called Wells Fargo and talked to them. But what my question is to you, you know, and your story is remarkable. You came from a dairy farm, I believe, in Minnesota.
Correct.
And if you'd have taken a different choice, I grew up on a dairy farm, still part of our family farming operation. You know, I'm curious to know, you know, what you would do today if you'd have taken a different path and be a dairy farmer in Minnesota, and you had been trying to buy land and you were trying to buy some more cows. And you realize that your credit score, something's wrong with it. And you've not been able to get your credit score up. And all of a sudden you find out that maybe your credit score was dinged because your bank was opening accounts. I mean, when accounts are opened, it dings your credit score, correct?
That is correct.
That's right. So 2 million people potentially had their credit score dinged because someone else was opening accounts in their name. Is that correct?
That is not correct. There's about 565,000 credit cards, which we already now have contacted 20,000 of those, and less than 25% saying, and I don't want to minimize the numbers. These are still big numbers. One is too many. But we're going to go back, and my instruction is make it right for every one of those customers.
Here's what I was surprised to just watch a little bit ago when Mr. Cleaver was asking you, what was the highest level officer at Wells Fargo to be fired? And you didn't really know. You kind of said manager.
Well, I know the title. I know the functional title. I don't know if that person is a vice president, a senior vice president. I just don't know that. I do know that it's a manager. It's a branch manager's manager. And we're also not done with our investigation.
I understand. But, you know, this broke for the public within the past month. You apparently knew about it, 2013?
We knew that not everyone does it right. It was sometime in 2015 we did our PwC study, and those results came in early in 16.
You're the CEO when 939 employees are fired for improper sales in 2011. In 2012, another 1,000. All you have to do is stand up in front of your company, and I know it's a large company, mm-hmm. and say, this is going to stop. And it should be stopping. I'm curious to hear from employees who were fired what their experience was. And I hope we do a hearing with some of those. But let me ask you this. Wells Fargo is a huge company. Is it too big to manage?
No, it is not. This was a focus problem. We do a lot of areas really, really well, like model risk and market risk and capital liquidity. We know we have work to do in operational and compliance risk. We should have invested more. Today, I've told our folks, no stone unturned, no dollar unspent, get this right, and we're getting rid of sales goals.
I know you said that today, but where was the outrage from you a couple years ago when you first heard about it? I mean, there's outrage on this committee, and rightly so. I'm outraged about it, but I don't sense the same outrage from you when we're seeing your, the lady here, her name is Ms. Tolstedt, I believe. She's walking away with millions of dollars. The American people and your customers are going to be very upset when they see exactly what happens here. Final question, and I hope that you will, I didn't hear the question from this committee, but will you get the number to this committee of CFPB regulators that were embedded at Wells Fargo Bank?
I can talk to our team, and we'll be as cooperative as we can. I don't know, you know, whether that's covered under, you know, confidential supervisory, but I'll be as helpful as I can be on that
issue. Please do that. I think that, you know, not only have you and Wells Fargo let customers down, but so has CFPB, and people across this country are mad at both.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Minnesota, Mr. Ellison.
Mr. Chairman, ask for unanimous consent to enter into the record a report entitled Banking on the Hard Sell, Low Wages and Aggressive Sales Metrics Put Bank Workers and Customers at Risk. I'd like to enter it into the record.
Without objection.
I'd also like to enter into the record an op-ed I wrote in the Daily Beast just the other day entitled John Stumpf's Wells Fargo Racket Shows Why Bank Workers Need a Union.
Without objection.
And I'd also just like to note for my colleagues, the Progressive Caucus held a June 10th briefing listening to the workers that we've been talking about today. We'd be happy to do another one, but on June 10th, we had workers come in and testify to the very thing that we've been talking about today, which is these high-pressure sales techniques. Mr. Stumpf, if you're a worker at Wells Fargo, and you are expected to seek out and reach sales goals, you mentioned that, right?
We had sales goals.
Yes or no, sir, because I don't have a lot of time. I'm not trying to be unkind to you, but I'm not going to let you waste my time. Okay, so yes or no?
Yes, we had sales
goals.
Okay,
thank you. So could you tell me, do you all have something known as prospecting calls that were expected for bankers to make?
I don't know that level of detail.
So you don't know whether there was prospecting
calls?
Do you deny that there were prospecting calls?
I do not know that level of detail in our retail bank.
Are you aware that each banker was expected to make at least 100 prospecting calls a day? Are you aware of that?
That's the first time I've ever heard that.
Mr. CEO Chairman, are you aware that there were weekly meetings held by, no, morning huddles to talk about these sales goals. Are you aware of that?
I realize, I know that some...
you got to answer yes or no, sir.
But it's yes with an explanation.
Well, okay, so morning huddles or not, yes or no? Did they occur?
Yes, with an explanation.
All right. At these morning huddles, were there questions asked of workers, how are they going to sell more credit cards, and were they given goals for specifically selling a number of credit cards?
I don't know that everyone holds. I have to give you an explanation, sir.
Equity loans, were they given goals?
I don't know that. I don't know that every branch held a morning huddle. I know our team works together.
Were there publishing of charts on who sold how many products in your bank?
That's a level I do not know that detail.
Were they publishing charts on who did not make their sales goals?
Again, I don't have that level of detail.
Workers say that there were.
Okay.
Now, if a worker did not reach their sales goals, were they put on initial written warnings?
I don't know the process, and we got rid of sales goals.
Excuse me, if workers did not meet second sales goals again, were they given second warnings?
I don't know that level of detail.
Okay, if they were not reached second warnings, were they written up, given written admonishments for not making sales goals?
Congressman, you're asking a question I can't answer.
So you're the CEO and you don't know this. And were they given performance improvement plans if they did not make sales goals?
Congressman, I don't know that level of detail.
All right. And how did you generate these lists for workers to have to make calls? How were the lists generated?
Congressman, I don't even know if there were lists. I just don't know that level of detail.
Okay, so you're the CEO, and you don't know if there were sales, if there were prospecting lists that each worker was made to make cold calls on.
I don't know that level of detail, Congressman.
Okay, and if sales weren't important, you know, why were workers given credit card and home equity loan goals to meet?
Yeah, I don't know what their goals were. We want to deepen relationships.
Why were workers encouraged to open numerous accounts for customers?
Our team members are encouraged to sit down with a customer, talk about their financial journey, and help provide the right products and services.
So if a worker got a person to open up an account, isn't it true that that account, let's say a debit account, that there has to be a certain minimum balance in that account and there is a fee to hold that account if there's not the minimum balance met? Am I right about that?
I don't believe you are right about that, Congressman.
If there's an account,
I don't believe that's correct.
If there's an account, does there have to be a certain number of uses of that debit account per month?
I believe that's one way to avoid.
And if there's not met, is there a fee associated with that?
I believe there's a minimum balance.
What is that fee? What is the minimum balance fee?
I don't know what those numbers are.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from South Carolina, Mr. Mulvaney.
Thank the chairman, Mr. Stumpf, from over here. I don't know. I can't tell you how disappointed I am to even have to be here today as one of the many members of this committee who every single day in here defend the banking system, defend capitalism, defend free markets, to sit here and have to watch you essentially validate everything that the other side has said about you and your business and your industry, I don't know, for the last three or four generations, is extraordinarily disappointing to me. And the damage that you have done to the market, to your industry, far exceed the damage that you've done to your own business. But again, there's nothing I can do about that. I want to ask you, I think, just one question. I know a little bit about business, not nearly as much as you do. What little I do know, I didn't learn from college or business school. I learned from my dad, who was actually raised very similar to you. He was from Minnesota, born to a lower middle class family, went to Winona, went on to the university, mm-hmm. A little bit older than you, but not much. And I remember him telling me one time when I was first getting into business, he said, you know what, you can learn a lot about an enterprise, about an organization, by looking at the leader, and that the organization will take on the personality of the leader, or the owner, or the person in charge. And if you walk into somebody's, you walk into a lobby and you're received nicely by the young man who's sitting there answering phones, it's probably a really good indication that the lady that owns the place is a really good person. Conversely, if you walk in and you get treated like crap and with disdain, it probably says a lot about the people at the top of the chain.
I happen to think that the folks that work with me in my office reflect that. You come to my office, you get treated well, because that's important to me. The place that you ran, Mr. Stumpf, and I don't know that much about Wells. I knew a little bit while Covey and Wells, First Union, because of where I grew up. I mean, y'all were rotten. We've heard some stories today that everybody's heard about. I'm sitting here looking at the story from 2009 about the lawsuit that got filed. It says Wells Fargo, Ms. Jacobson said, and it's New York Times, saw the black community as fertile ground for subprime mortgages as working class blacks were hungry to be part of the nation's homegrowing mania. Loan officer, she said, in an affidavit, stated that employees referred to blacks as mud people and to subprime lending as ghetto loans. I can't tell you how hard it is for me to even say that. Y'all targeted black churches. I'm not going to defend that. That doesn't even deserve defense. I'm going to ask you one question. Does this organization reflect you?
Well,
you're in charge.
I am deeply sorry, and I've read that article that you just said, and that has no place in our culture, no place in what we've done, and we are today the largest lender to low and moderate income people on housing. We make more loans to African Americans, Latinos, persons of color, and we're proud of that. And that place and that kind of language and that kind of behavior is not who I am. I've learned my life lessons also from my parents. My dad is 94, and he's still a wonderful guy and is still a big influence in my life, and so is my mother. And I try to lead with courage and conviction. Our company is based on those values of ethics, of doing what's right, and the company, of course we've made mistakes. Not everybody lives up to our vision and values, but the vision and values our 268,000 people aspire to and do every day is consistent with what I want to live my life and what our culture is of our company.
Thank you, Mr. Stumpf. I appreciate that. For the minute I have left, I want to say something to my Democrat colleagues. Well, I know we'll see this, and believe me, if the roles were reversed, I might see this as an opportunity to try and push a political initiative, a political agenda, to bang the drums for more heavy regulation. Everything that we're talking about here today, including what I just read, which I won't read again, happened since CFPB and Dodd-Frank. It happened after we supposedly fixed all of this with regulation. And maybe I would suggest this. You can't fully regulate bad actors. I'm not here in a position to say if Mr. Stumpf is a bad person or not. That's not up to me. I'm not trying not to be in the position of judging other people. That's for his board. I know how I would vote if I were on the board. In fact, he wouldn't even be here if I were on the board of that company. But you're never going to be able to fully regulate bad actors. And I hope we look at this with a certain level-headedness as we move forward. Thank you.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Perlmutter.
First, Mr. Chair, I'd like to introduce into the record the reports, the community banking reports, of May 24, 2016 from Wells Fargo.
Without objection.
And the report from May 20th, 2014.
Without objection.
Mr. Stumpf, about 8 years ago, you were before this committee, and I was so proud of you and proud of Wells Fargo and the fact that I thought you guys operated as a bank and really looked after me, a customer, somebody who's been with the bank. I mean, all these young guys. I've been with one of the predecessor banks for 40 years.
Thank you.
And, you know, I represented some of the predecessors, First Interstate, Security Pacific, United. Mm-hmm. The culture is what I want to talk about, mm-hmm. because that really is you and it is your board of directors.
Correct.
And I've heard terms today that I don't really align with the banking business, if you will. I look at banks as something different. We came in with $800 billion to save the banking system when it was collapsing. Because it's something different. But I hear you use words today, and this is where I think the root of this problem is. Sales organization, retail sales, stores. I've never, ever in my life referred to my branch bank in Applewood, Colorado, as a store. You don't sell Vegematics. You don't sell grapefruit. You take people's money, you safeguard it, and you lend it out to people who may need it at for interest, maybe me. And to get in, this is where Mr. Green was going with the products. I don't know how many products you got. I looked at my account. I do like the online banking, by the way, because I can look at all my accounts. I turn out, as Mr. Roy says, I have 8 accounts, personal accounts with you. How I have 8, the grade 8, I don't know. But I do. So talk to me about why you're calling these things stores. Yep. Why you use words like retail sales and cross-selling. You're a bank.
We are a bank, and the idea here is that we want to make sure our team members, when you come into a bank, or any one of our customers do, that we treat them with respect and that we provide products and services that help them. When they do more with us, we give them a better deal. They get more value. It helps them and it helps us. And whether we call them a store or a branch or a location, it's in the hearts and minds of our people who are inside there.
So, and I'll accept that. But I still think you're a bank. And
we treat banks
differently than we treat grocery stores because you're the heart of the financial system. But here's where I want to go. So I go into my bank, and there's been some turnover there. They always treat me well. They're always very nice young people. Sometimes they're saying, you know, do you need this? Do you need that? I generally am saying no. When you talk about these goals that are established, why are you even setting goals? I mean, the goal should be if your customer needs something, try to help them.
Correct. We're getting rid of product sales goals, and the goal.
But why did you have the goals in the first place?
Well, it was an idea that for people to make sure that they use the right way of sitting down so they have a conversation with a customer. I don't want our people in our branches or our banks to be apathetic and just not care when people come in. I want them to sit down and have a conversation about where that customer is in their financial journey so they can meet a need with a product. And when it works well and it deepens relationships, everyone wins. No one should be ever, whatever the goals are, should be forcing a product or saying, why don't you do this? Or why don't you buy this? That's not the way we train. That's not the way we incent for. But even today, we have taken that off the table because we're learning that customers grow with us when they're happy, when they're satisfied. And our satisfaction scores and our loyalty scores have never been higher. That's a better way of doing business.
All right. And I'm just up here as a member of Congress who has worked with banks before, but I'm just telling you, you gotta stop. You know, our stores generate more deposits than our competitors. You know, you've got Denver up here on your chart. Yeah. That creates the wrong culture. And I yield back.
The time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. Pittenger.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Stumpf?
Yeah, hi.
Afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Ms. Stumpf, I'm from Charlotte.
Okay, great. We love Charlotte.
Well, you have a very major presence in our community. I think there's some 23,600 employees that
Correct.
Work there. They are my constituents. I do have deep respect and appreciation for the corporate citizenship that you all have been in Charlotte. You have been exemplary in terms of what you've done in our community. You take active roles, your employees do, in many nonprofit organizations. And that leadership is commended. And of course, we cherish the Wells Fargo Golf Tournament. And so you have a major presence in our community. And that's why today is such a sad day. I know it is for you. I'm sure as you look back on these 35 years and where you are today, you think, what if? What if I'd have done this? Mm-hmm. What differences could I have made? Where was I blindsided? What mistakes? Where did I err? Mm-hmm. And so I think I'm asking you to look as if you were sitting in our seat. We represent these people. As was said earlier, some 750 to 800,000 plus people. And you've heard a lot of outrage, a lot of righteous indignation, because we haven't seen what we've all expected. You know, in the South Park Wells Fargo facility that you have, there's written behind the teller station, the counter, a statement by Mr. Wells. It came from, I believe, 1864. Do you recall that statement? That I think it's very prominent, and perhaps it is another Wells Fargo. It seems to be the motto of your bank.
Are you asking me a question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I don't. He's made a lot of statements, but treat every customer with respect, and I can't recall.
What we have there at the South Park, it says we have one very powerful business rule. It is concentrated in one word, courtesy. So I think as you look at all of, there's a lot embedded in that word courtesy, but I think that's the challenge we have today. What could have been done different? Certainly the regulators were there, yet this was reported by a news agency. What would you have done different today? As you look back and the changes and the mistakes that were made as the CEO, what happened in that corporate culture that did not allow that information to come to you in a more timely fashion that would have caused you to take even greater direction in leadership?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. I've probably asked myself that 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times. And while, you know, I want to defend our culture and our people, I recognize that we could have done more earlier. And I don't know there's any one point, but surely we should have realized earlier that product sales goals could elicit behavior that's inconsistent with our culture. Even if it happened like this case with 1% of our team, it's way too much. It's simply not worth it. And frankly, it's not even consistent with where we're going given the business today. I don't know if I can be clearer than that. And there's a lot of people doing a lot of introspection within the company today to make sure that we never, ever put a customer or a team member, we want always customers to be the foremost of what we do. And if courtesy is the right word, we think of relationship. We love long-term, you know, mutually beneficial relationships with our owners, our team members, and most importantly, our customers.
Yes, sir. I think those of us who understand free markets, I was on a bank board, small bank, but we understood the customer, we understood the importance of the financial industry and what it does to facilitate economic growth. And that's why we're so challenged today, because we see there's been a strangling of regulations on the financial industry. And yet with that, we're having to deal with you and with this bank and with this problem that's going to have ripple effects. And the messaging is going to be there that there needs to be even more oppressive regulations.
Thank you.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Connecticut, Mr. Himes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Stumpf, we've focused a lot today on accountability. I want to go back to something that, like Congressman Lucas's concerns, troubles me, which is kind of the focus on culture and the materiality of what happened here. We're hearing that there's not a problem with the culture, and you're hearing an awful lot of disagreement up here. And we're hearing, certainly in the Senate hearing, that this wasn't material. And I guess if you sort of exquisitely, finely define materiality, the way maybe the SEC defines it, maybe $185 million in fines is not material. But this is about much more than a legal definition of materiality. And we need to hear you say that you understand the magnitude of what has occurred here. It's more than $185 million. It's about the trust and the faith and the belief in the system. It's not about the ups and downs of one company. It's about people's faith in the banking system. It's about their faith in the market economy. It's about whether competition is perceived as a good thing by the American public or a bad thing. This is really about people's faith in organizations like yours and like the one that you're testifying with in front of today. But let me start with the numbers quickly here. What matters to an investor, of course, is the value of the company they own. And your shareholders have already paid out $185 million, including, by the way, the state of Connecticut's pension funds. Mr. Stumpf, do you know what the market cap, the value of your company is today?
I didn't look this morning, but I think it's a $228 billion.
On September 7th, when this all started, it was $253 billion, and there's been no other material impact. So just this event has cut $25 billion off of the value of Wells Fargo. That's a big number. Do you know what the value of Ford Motor Company is, Mr. Stumpf?
I do not follow
it's
Ford.
$50 billion. So just since the 7th, you have, and your organization and the culture have obliterated a full half of a Ford Motor Company. That has to be material, doesn't it?
Congressman, I take this as much more than the $185 million. I don't want to diminish this. I am deeply sorry that we didn't do the right thing, and I understand that re-earning the trust of our customer and the American people is going to be our biggest challenge.
I appreciate that, and I do want to get away from the numbers because, again, I'm troubled by this whole culture thing. Do you think that you can fully measure Wells Fargo's value with the hard assets, the dollars and cents, the number of accounts? Let me ask it another way. Are intangible things like Wells Fargo's reputation and brand an important part of the company's value?
There's no question. I think the most important...
So yes, the answer is yes. Do you believe that Wells Fargo...
With an explanation, though, Matt.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
I think, frankly, what is in the hearts and minds of our people and the trust with our customer is by far the most important thing because they make all the rest happen.
Do you think that Wells Fargo's reputation has been damaged in a material way by this?
I think there's been damage, yes.
Okay. What I worry about is bigger than Wells Fargo. It's the fact that the system comes apart if people don't have faith and trust. Stumpf, can you see what I'm holding up right here?
It's a $1 bill.
It's the almighty dollar.
Yeah.
It's a piece of paper with some green ink on it.
Yes.
Does this thing have any intrinsic value? Can I eat it if I'm hungry? Can I use it to cut wood if I...
No.
Does it have any intrinsic value at all?
It represents a promise.
It's a promise.
Yes.
So it relies on the faith and the belief in the American people that this has some value. Otherwise, it's a piece of paper with green ink on it. Is that not correct?
I totally agree with you,
Congressman. And can I not expand that point to the banking system? If Americans really started getting anxious about the fact that you don't have enough money in your banks on any given day to cover their deposits, we'd have a problem, wouldn't we?
There's no question about that.
And the only thing standing between us and this meaning being meaningless and between them believing that the banking system doesn't work is trust and faith in the fact that it does.
Congressman, you are absolutely right. Trust is the absolute critical element here, and we have a lot of work to do to work on that.
So your investors are equity investors. They accept risk, including the possibility that something like this could happen. If you don't want this kind of risk, you buy bonds or treasuries or whatever it is. I would implore you, as somebody who I think understands that the market economy is important and that the financial services industry is important, I would implore you to please don't continue to focus on this idea that this is not material. I think we're now agreeing that it is material.
I've never said that.
And please work with your colleagues to repair some of the damage that has been done to the faith and the trust that we both here today have acknowledged is the only underpinning of the system that has done so well by you, sir.
Thank you for your comments, and I couldn't agree more. This is bigger than the 185. In fact, I don't even think in those terms, regaining trust.
Thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentlelady from Missouri, Ms. Wagner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Stumpf, you've come before this committee today to answer for the appalling actions taken by your company, Wells Fargo. I have a number of questions, but I want to start by expressing my outrage. Outrage that your company was taking advantage of your customers, our constituents, for years and years and years. I don't understand how your employees could create millions of unauthorized accounts without someone raising a red flag. And if that happened, how you failed to act on that knowledge. You had a responsibility to your customers, and you failed. Big time. Placing one's money and wealth in the custody of an organization like Wells Fargo is one of the biggest displays of, what are we talking about? Public trust. Mm-hmm. And you, sir, and your company have betrayed that trust and taken advantage of consumers in order to meet sales performance goals and fraudulently improve earnings and share prices. This is wrong, this is immoral, and this may even be criminal. And as you stated, sir, the buck stops with you. Not only did Wells Fargo and your employees fail these customers, but our regulators failed as well. They neither identified nor prevented this malpractice from occurring in the first place. It wasn't the OCC or the CFPB that first uncovered these deceptive sales practices that were taking place, but it was, in fact, the LA Times, the media, that first brought your company's shameful practices to light. And while it is the regulator's job to prosecute the banking institutions that break the law, it is our job as members of Congress to prosecute the regulators who were, in fact, asleep at the wheel. From what we know, and there is a lot that we don't know, sir, this widespread abuse was occurring as long ago as 2011. Some have said maybe back as far as 2007, with 1,000 employees being terminated every year for creating fraudulent accounts. Yet this behavior persisted for years without management intervening. And even when regulators began to investigate, Wells Fargo did nothing to notify customers and shareholders. Your company abused its customers. While you have apologized, that apology carries no weight with me, sir. You still have a lot to explain to this committee and, frankly, to my constituents. Mr. Stumpf, how many of your customers have been impacted by your fraudulent activities?
Well, I don't know. I know what the PwC numbers showed.
What is that number?
There was 2 million accounts that they could not rule out, and now we're going back and contacting those customers. Within our credit card business, as I mentioned, we've already talked to 20,000 of them.
How many in Missouri, Mr. Stumpf?
I can get you that.
Quickly as you can, please. How many customers have been abused in my home state of Missouri?
There were 1,191 accounts.
What portion of these customers were defrauded after you became aware of the fraudulent activities?
I don't know what, I don't have a timeline on that. I just know it broken out by credit card.
So over 2
deposits.
Million customers, you're going back to even find out there are more, and you don't have a timeline? When you have a timeline for the employees that you fired year after year after year, but you have no timeline of the number of fraudulent accounts?
I can work on that and get that to you. I don't happen to have it in my book right now here.
You
for
keep
you.
Saying, sir, that you're going to make it right.
Correct.
Those are your words. You're going to make it right. I'd like to know when. When will these customers be made whole, Mr. Stumpf? When will we know, and when will they know, whether their credit scores have been affected? When?
Yes, well, we're starting to work on that right now, and we've already talked to 20,000 of our customers, and we're hearing that 75% or less than 25% either didn't want the card or didn't know they had the card, and then we're going to
20,000 out of 2 million plus customers? You're just getting started now?
No, the
it took 5 years, sir, just to identify and begin rectifying the problem, and Wells Fargo only just announced their sales incentives will eliminate in October.
Maybe just
when will customers, will they have to wait 5 years, sir,
okay,
or longer in order to get relief?
The 20,000 we've talked so far is out of the 565,000. Other ones did not have, from my understanding, a bureau involved, but we're going to talk to all of our customers. We're going to contact all of them.
Time of the gentlelady has expired.
Thank
the
you,
chair
Mr.
now recognizes the gentleman from Delaware, Mr. Carney.
Mr. Trump, I represent the whole state of Delaware. It's over 900,000 people, one of the bigger districts here in the Congress. We are a banking center, as you may know. We don't have a huge Wells Fargo presence, but could you look in your book, please, and find out how many fraudulent accounts were attributed to people who live in the state of Delaware so I know okay. What we're talking about.
I can tell you how many accounts that the PwC analysis could not rule out. These aren't, again.
And your commitment is to make right each of these accounts in some way or
exactly
another.
Right. In Delaware, let me see if I have this number right.
So while you're looking at it.
Yeah, 4,255 accounts.
So my responsibility is to make sure, and your commitment is to make sure that each of those accounts will be, you will make right by those people.
We're gonna go contact every deposit account. We're gonna talk to every credit card customer that we can make contact with. We'll try to contact all 565 in your district or in your state. There looks like there's 1,793 cards, and again, I don't know how many of those won't be wanted versus wanted, and we're going to look for the secondary harm.
Thank you very much. So part of our responsibility as members of Congress in this hearing is to figure out what went wrong, whether people are being held accountable, and most importantly, what we should be doing going forward. Correct. And the thing that I'm struggling with is how long this went on before you were able to stop it. And you've heard that question on and on again.
Correct.
And it does for me, as Mr. Stutzman asked from the other side of the aisle, and by the way, I agree with Mr. Capuano, there are very few issues in the 6 years that I've been here where both sides of the aisle are on the same page. Mm-hmm. Mr. Meeks and Mr. Capuano and Mr. Posey and Mr. Duffy are outraged on the same subject. You know that something really is going on here. Mm-hmm. So what about that question about whether this is an institution that's too big to manage?
You know, again, as I mentioned to another
Mr. Stutzman asked the question.
Yes, and I think this is a focus problem. We can get our arms around